Hello and welcome to the International Desalination Association Young Leaders Programme webinar series. Today, in the first of our quarterly webinars, we welcome Dr. Rick Stover of Desalitech and Dr. Matan Beery of akvolution. The format for the day will be a 25-minute presentation from each of the speakers, and then 10 minutes, rather, for questions once both speakers have presented. Before we start, let me give you a brief overview of the Young Leaders Programme. The IDA Young Leaders Program is open to any IDA member 35 years of age or under. Our main goals are to promote desalination careers and provide a forum for communication. In particular, we provide a monthly bulletin, a quarterly webinar, quarterly networking events, and an annual $10,000 PhD scholarship. For more information, join us at idayp.org. We now move to our first speaker, Dr. Rick Stover, who is Vice President of Desalitech, a reverse osmosis water treatment company. Today, Dr. Stover will give an overview of his work in desalination and Desalitech's high recovery, low energy RO technology. Over to you, Dr. Stover.
Hello. Thanks to the IDA and the Young Leaders Program for hosting this event and for giving me the opportunity to meet you. So I'll give just a few words about my background and my perspective on water startups. I'm a chemical engineer working in industry for 25 years, most of that time being as chief technical officer for Energy Recovery, which is a company that produces energy recovery devices and pumps, mostly for seawater desalination. So I joined when it was a startup, and by the time I left, it was being traded on the NASDAQ stock exchange. My interest in new desalination technologies led me to join Oasis Water, a forward osmosis company here in Boston. But it turned out to be too early stage for me. And then finally, I moved back into reverse osmosis when I joined Desalitech in 2010, this being my third water startup. So the financing of all three of the companies I've been involved in were different. ERI was funded by angel investors. The time from first money in to first money out was a little under 20 years. To give you some perspective on the time that can be required for startups to get started. But a lot of people made a lot of money on it eventually, and they still do. Oasis was funded with venture capital and is still a going concern. And Desalitech is funded by private equity investors, ones with strategic knowledge of the water industry. So, and I can say that having a purely financial investor that brings strategic insights and connections has proven to be very beneficial. So lessons learned, briefly. Beginning, growing, and exiting a company is a relay race. So the aptitudes and attitudes required to be a successful startup are different from those required to produce a product or a service economically. And then taking a company through a merger or IPO takes a completely different set of skills. Usually this means old people need to go and new people need to join. Similarly, if you are considering joining a startup company, you should figure out what stage you're good at and choose appropriately. So another lesson learned, they'll never line up at your door. Even the best technologies and products must be sold, and sold hard. And finally, it takes a lot of time and many revisions to make something simple. So the simpler, the better. Okay, so now I'm going to talk about Desalitech and closed-circuit desalination. Desalitech is, while I'm booting this up, the next generation of reverse osmosis. And I claim this because it addresses the most significant weaknesses of conventional reverse osmosis, but it uses only standard RO components. So So they're no new proprietary devices, just a smart new way of putting them together. Okay. So this is context. Industry cannot afford to waste water or pay high treatment costs. We're focusing on industrial water treatment initially, although as a reverse osmosis platform, it applies to, you know, any desalination, brackish water, or water treatment application. But on the industrial side, scarcity and urbanization, all of the things that accelerate demand in every sector are pressing on industry as well. Already an estimated 70% of U.S. factories purify their water, and RO is what you use if you can in terms of drinking water or high purity water because of its portability and its low energy consumption. So industry, it's just going to keep growing. Anticipation is that it'll become an $80 billion market, industrial water treatment. So for this, reverse osmosis works great, but it generates a pretty heavy brine stream, a lot of flow of brine that needs to be disposed of or dealt with. Still, energy use is pretty high, and RO membranes risk fouling and scaling. So this sort of bar chart on the right here shows that actually in developed countries, the industrial sector uses the majority of water, fresh water, available fresh water. And the combination of industry and agriculture, no matter where you are in the world, is pushing 90% of the overall freshwater withdrawals. So this introduces closed circuit desalination, Desalitech's patented process. As I said, it's made with standard equipment, including membranes, pumps, pressure vessels, things that those in the industry are familiar with. But in a new configuration that achieves high water recovery, better utilization of source water, which go to hand in hand, and reduce waste generation. The process resists fouling and scaling, and that's very interesting how it does that, and I'll explain it. Reduces energy requirements and provides a level of flexibility that's pretty new and very beneficial, again, in industrial water treatment applications. The company has 22 plants running for as long as over 5 years. So it's pretty well proven and established. All right, this is my most technical slide. I'm going to explain how the process works here. And I'll start that with the top picture showing a two-stage conventional RO system. So you see a high-pressure pump feeding membrane arrays, and then a booster pump and also a throttle valve shown, maybe just one or the other. The function of that being to help balance fluxes between the two stages. So the amount of recovery you can get per stage is limited. It's limited by the fact that RO is a cross-flow technology. You need to have water flowing past the tail membrane elements for them to work. So you can't take out more than about half the pure water, half of the fresh water from what you're treating before you need to go into a new stage. I mentioned flux balancing, that's really pressure control. You also need to control flow, again, to provide cross flow. All right, so longer arrays or multi-stages that aren't well balanced risk high flux through the lead membrane elements. This is where the salinity is the lowest and the pressure is the highest. So, and high flux is, you know, well documented to increase risk of fouling. And then also in high recovery applications, as the salinity increases, as the concentration of sparingly soluble salts increases, there's risk of scaling or precipitation, especially in the tail elements. Okay, below is introducing the CCD process. You'll see two things right away. One is that the membrane array is shorter. Of course, this is just one pressure vessel shown. There'll be multiple vessels in parallel. So no fewer membranes overall, but arranged with three or four elements in a line. So that's the first thing. Second thing is that you see brine recirculation. So the concentrate is coming back into the membrane feed. So the process operates in a batch mode or a semi-batch mode, we call it. And I'll click this little animation here, which then hopefully you'll see.
concentration, pressure rising, and then at the end of the concentration cycle, a throttle valve opens, and the concentrate is pushed out of the process. So it operates as a closed circuit during pressurization, and then at the end it goes through a flushing step where the brine is ejected out of the system. The high pressure pump flows continuously, and permeate production continues throughout the whole process. So hence the semi-batch, whereas a batch process would stop and start. So in this process, recovery is nothing to do with how many membranes you have in a row, rather how long you allow the system to recirculate for before you eject the brine. Crossflow is set by this CP, the circulation pump, and that's an independently controllable process function. So you set that circulation pump to give you the crossflow that you want. The flux distribution is enhanced by the fact that the membrane array is short. The fouling and scaling resistance comes from the fact that the salinity in the system is increasing and then decreasing in a cyclic manner everywhere. So in thinking about fouling, biofilms can grow almost in any salinity, but changing the salinity tends to disrupt film growth. Scaling occurs if there's supersaturation, but some time is required for precipitation to establish itself. So if the system is flushed in shorter than the induction time for sparingly soluble salts to precipitate, you can trick scaling, if you will, or achieve high supersaturation. Again, if it's only momentary and the system is flushed regularly with the feed water. And then finally, the reduced energy consumption comes from the fact that the pressure at the beginning of each cycle is low, and then eventually increases to the pressure that a conventional RO system requires. But the energy, the pressure that you need and the energy corresponding to it is the average, which is typically 35% lower than that required for multi-stage RO under the same conditions. Okay, I'm going to briefly talk about how these processes are designed, not so much to teach you how to do it, but rather to show you that it's pretty transparent. So we use the same tools that one would use for designing conventional RO systems, the main one being membrane projection programs, so ROSA, IMS Design, Q+, Torrey DS, the basic tools. And then you do multiple iterations. So you do an initial modeling of your feed water, and then two more, total of three iterations through the membrane projections. And they tell you the usual information, the flows, pressures, and composition of the streams. And then you put that all together in a spreadsheet. It's pretty straightforward. This, what we did with this data is went ahead and went through an 11-cycle process and did the projections for each cycle. The first step you'll see is low flux. This is the flushing step. It's operating at 40% recovery at reduced pressure. The rest of the steps, 2 through 11, are the closed loop ones, the closed circuit ones. And you see that recovery, this column, I don't know if you can see my pointer, but the fourth from the right, that recovery is building, eventually achieving 89 or 90% recovery in this case with each recirculation. What's very interesting about these modeling results is the TDS increase inside the closed loop increases linearly. Similarly, the feed pressure required increases linearly. So what that lets us do is just model the first cycle 2, the first closed circuit cycle, and the last, and average them. Again, for getting the average feed pressure and the average predicting the TDS. So DP throughout this is pretty constant. All right. So let's talk about high recovery. What are the things that limit recovery? And by the way, high recovery is one of the primary goals in brackish water treatment, in inland desalination, in industrial water treatment, because typically disposal costs, brine disposal costs, are the highest cost of ownership component. And as opposed to energy and seawater desalination, really brine disposal is the most expensive piece. And typically brine disposal is paid for on a volumetric basis. Okay, so first is scaling. So the precipitation of sparingly soluble salts limit recovery in any RO system. A second factor is complexity. If you want 90% recovery, it may require 3 or 4 stages of membrane elements, and that makes design and operation complicated. Permeate composition. So you may have a permeate TDS that you're trying to hit or go below, and that might limit your recovery rate. Effluent composition, again, if you're discharging to the sewer and the POTW says you can only have so much TDS, you're limited. And then finally, the pressure rating of the equipment. Let's say you're using 450 PSI rated pressure vessels, that limits how high you can go on recovery. So all these things are the limits on recovery. Here's how the closed circuit approach allows you to either improve on or outright get around these limitations. Scaling, as I said, the system flushes itself with each cycle. And if the cycle time is less than induction time, then you're not limited by scaling. You can go to higher recovery rates. Complexity, CCD systems are single stage. The flow balances and the flux balances almost automatically. Permeate composition can limit your recovery rate with a CCD process. But if the feed salinity goes down such that you can tolerate higher recovery in your permeate composition, then you can do that. And similar with effluent composition and pressure. And the CCD system has a flexibility where recovery is a process variable set at the control panel. In the interest of time, I'll kind of go through this one very briefly. This just shows some work done on batch RO systems at the University of Texas, El Paso. And it's not a CCD system, but it's a batch system. But what they did was achieved over 1,300 parts per million of silica, which, if you know silica, regardless of the pH, 1,300 is exceedingly high. And they did that. They were able to get away with that because they were using a cycling process. High recovery saves money, as I've said, and here's some numbers to back that up. For a given permeate flow rate, raising recovery up saves feed water and reduces brine reject, such that for a 200 GPM system, you can be looking at almost $300,000 per year in savings, which more than pays for the system in 1 year. And then the energy case, here's some numbers from modeling for what would, I guess, be a typical for very high recovery operation. In this case, the process is saving 32% of the energy that would be required by a conventional RO system, the design illustrated in the drawings above. Okay, to wrap up then, this approach is useful for actually both reverse osmosis and nanofiltration. It's a new approach for achieving high recovery rates. It's the main thing we're going after. Standard equipment, but a new configuration. And then design with tools that we're familiar, most in the industry are familiar with. It provides a level of flexibility that hasn't been seen before. Very good flux distribution, in particular limited lean element flux, so it helps reduce fouling and therefore maintenance. And then finally, reduced energy consumption. Open it up to questions.
Great. Thanks very much, Dr. Stover. And just as a reminder regarding questions, you can visit our video on YouTube, and please do go ahead and post any questions you might have just below the video. What we're going to do is come back to the questions once we've heard from our next speaker, and they can be questions either for Dr. Stover or Dr. Beery, our next speaker. Now, for our second and our final talk today, we welcome Dr. Matan Beery, who is a founder and CEO at akvolution, a startup company focused on the development of advanced seawater pretreatment systems. Dr. Beery will outline the key factors for successful innovation and the steps needed to start and finance a company in the water sector. Over to you now, Dr. Beery.
Thank you, Rowan. So, let me get my slide. There you go. So it's a great pleasure and honor taking part of the first IDA YLP webinar. I hope there will be many more to come. I have to apologize. My voice is a little fragile. I had a serious cold a couple of weeks ago and shake it off. But I'll try using a loud and clear voice. And in case anything isn't clear, just pop a question at the end. So my presentation today will be divided into two parts. First of all, I'm going to talk about generally innovation, entrepreneurship as a topic, more specifically in the water industry. So what's the difference between small and big companies? What's it like starting your own company, getting finance, and what are the basic requirements, in my opinion, for success? And then I'm going to go to the second part of the presentation, which is basically the story behind my company, akvolution, our timeline, our innovation, our product, and I'm going to sum things up at the end. So I'm guessing many of the YLP viewers out there are thinking about starting their career in the water business or in the desal industry. And many of you are probably faced with a dilemma, should I go for a small company or for a big company? And I'd like to first start saying a few good words about small and medium enterprises. So small companies, SMEs, are usually defined as companies having less than 250 employees, in some countries 100 employees, and less than $50 million in turnover yearly. And these companies are extremely important for the economy because, first of all, they make 99% of all registered companies. Most importantly, they increase liquidity, flexibility, agility, and the degree of innovation in the market. So if we think about the desalination market, the two major innovations that were really a game changer in the industry in the past 30 years, so thin film composite membranes and energy recovery device, pressure exchangers, both came from basically startup companies, Film Tech and ERI, and they really pushed things forward. Third point, small companies provide actually about two-thirds of all jobs on the market. So about 70% in Europe, about 60% in the US. So they play a major role as provider of jobs. Last point, which is actually quite interesting and almost shocking, is that actually in the last 30, 40 years, especially in the US, small and medium enterprises are actually the ones, the only ones creating new, real new jobs on the market. So if you take a look at netto or net job creation on the market, the large companies have either zero job creation or actually negative job creation or job destruction, usually because of cutbacks or outsourcing to other countries. And even if they do employ new people, they do employ new people, they cut off more jobs on the other end. And small and medium enterprises are the ones that are really creating the new jobs on the market net. And if you think about the high unemployment rates that are going now, especially in Europe and Southern Europe, have numbers 40% unemployment rates in population of 20-year-olds. these small companies are really important in getting these people a job. So these were just a few words in favor of small companies. And I've made a comparison working for a big or a small company. And small company, in this case, a startup. So why work for a startup company? Well, the pay is actually usually lower than what you get for in a big company. The job security is lower. Many startup companies don't make it. Working hours are usually more than what you have in big companies. So you find yourself really working on weekends and during the night. However, in small companies, startup companies, you have a lot more room for creativity, unlike big companies. You have lower risk of burnout, proven. And maybe most importantly, you do your job because you're really passionate about it and not because your boss tells you to. So I've read a survey in Israel asking people, young founders of startup companies, what were the reasons that motivated them to start their own company? And actually, the top three in the survey were the founders wanted to change the world. So they saw a real problem, they saw a real need in the market, and they thought, I can give a better solution than anything else out there. Second reason, they want to control their own destiny. So obviously, you start your own company, you are your own boss, you have much more control over your career. And three, founders seem to be liking taking risks. I've made a very basic diagram of what free market economy looks like today. In most developed countries. So you have workers at the lower end, most people, and you have managers above them, entrepreneurs or business owners above them, and then eventually investors at the very top. And you have investment usually in the form of money going down and return of investment going back up. So basically, the higher you are this pyramid, the more creative control you have, more flexibility, usually the higher the pay and the benefits, and you also enjoy higher social status. But it also comes at a price of more responsibility and higher risk. And the nice thing about most developed countries is that we have real meritocracy, which means you can change your position within this pyramid if you work hard enough. So I hope these were all good reasons for you to think about starting your own company. Here comes some of the more realistic part, which is starting your own company, especially in the water business, is a really hard job, and you're faced with some really difficult years at the beginning. So I have here plotted the typical startup timeline diagram with revenues on the left side, time in years going horizontally. And you can usually divide the times, the cycles in the startup lifespan into several parts. So first one is pre-seed. This is usually the part where you only have a basic idea, very, very early stage. You don't have a product, you still didn't found your company yet. This is where you start really taking first steps into making things happen. You put your team together, you develop your first version of your product, and then then you move into the second part, which is the seed phase, usually between 1 and 3 years. This is the place, this is the time where you found your company. You continue developing your product. You write, you write a solid business plan, you start hiring employees, and usually you start selling at that point. At some point, usually a serious investor will come along. And this is what is usually called the first round of funding. And the big challenge is crossing the valley of death. This is the period, usually mostly in the seed phase, between the first and third or fourth year, where you spend a lot of money. You have not enough sales to create profit, and you're working against the clock. So this is really, I mean, some people call this part here courage and this part endurance. So this is the real challenge for a startup, crossing the valley of death and eventually hitting break even and really starting to grow. Now, this timeline usually applies for startup companies in the IT industry, where most startup companies are founded. But in the water sector, and I think Rick already emphasized it, this whole cycle, this whole lifespan is much more longer. This is usually because of the water sector being more conservative, so you can easily double the time that you see here. So I'd say about 7 or 8 years minimum are required to really start seeing profit. So about getting financed in the different early stages. So in the pre-seed phase, really just the beginning, the first year, people usually rely on family, friends, and fools to give them money. They invest their own money, or they get some kinds of grants, for example, from the government or from other organizations like business incubators. The second phase, the seed phase, that's usually where you see more grants and business incubators or accelerators taking a major role in financing startups. This is also the part where you can start getting government or state loans, and usually also the part where private investors, also known as business angels, come aboard and put in money for equity. Usually at some point you hit your first round, and this is where venture capital money usually starts getting into the picture. You can also take loans. Sometimes you can already be financed by private equity at this stage, or also start selling shares on the market. Here are some organizations that are kind of familiar, at least in Europe or in the U.S., that are Oz Industries, also in Australia, that are giving out money, sometimes without wanting any equity or return during the pre-seed and the seed phase. So if you think about starting your own company, start thinking about how to finance your company in the early stage and start looking for people or organizations that give out money at this early part. Yeah, choosing the right investor, especially in the water industry, is extremely important. The best investors are ones with deep pockets that will allow you to cross the valley of death. Are also ones with patience, ones that know that it takes a longer time in the water business to create a successful company. And usually best investors are ones giving you smart money. So not just pure financial investment. I think Rick also talked about this topic, but also giving you insight, knowledge, contacts in the water business that really help you open doors and grow your business. Some basic requirements for success. This is measured and analyzed by different research institutes in the startup scene. And this specifically applies also for the water industry. So in order for a startup to be successful in the water industry, it has to have an addressable market size of at least $100 million a year, preferably $1 billion a year. Otherwise, it's too small. The product market fit has to be good, which means ideally having a market pull instead of a product push. Product market fit solution, which means there's a real need in the market that will accept your solution really fast. You have to innovate in both technology and in your business plan, so making things better and different, not only in terms of your product, but also the way you sell it, the way you present it, the way you finance yourself. You gotta have a strong management team, so having only technical people is definitely not enough. You gotta have an all-around team consisting of both technical and business experts. And I think especially in hardware, old economy, and in the water industry, you gotta have adult supervision early on. So you must have at least one person on the team that's been around for 20, 30 years, knows exactly how the market works, has the contacts, has the network, and helps young founders from making big mistakes. Another critical point is securing your intellectual property. This seems to be a very crucial point, especially for water startups. You have to make sure you protect or possess some kind of intellectual property through patents. And over there, you have to take a look. Is it pending, granted? Are you using licensed patents? Are you licensing your patents? Is it defendable? So all of these are criteria needed for success as a startup in the water market. Five steps in bringing new technology to the water market are research and development, proof of concept with your technology, usually in small scale, then upscaling to a demonstration plant, ideally already on a commercial scale, then commercialization of your technology, and then starting having real market share. And during these five steps, you usually run out of money, have new competition in the market, lose or don't have your IP granted, are confronted with new regulations, especially environmental regulations, and perhaps most importantly, fighting to getting your technology to actually work in the field and survive the scale-ups. So that was it for the first part. Now I'm going to talk more specifically about my company, about akvolution. And we are obviously in the water industry and focus on pretreatment for seawater RO. As you probably know, not every open intake seawater looks like this, like in our vacation maybe, but quite often you see such images, especially where seawater is needed for desalination. So seawater that is contaminated, suffers from algae blooms, oil spills, high turbidity, high suspended solid concentration. And these kind of bad seawater or low quality seawater is causing major problems for RO plants. I think Global Water Intelligence put out in their latest market trends. Pretreatment is still a huge problem in desalination seawater RO plants, and it is estimated today that about 30% of large desalination plants around the world are not working as they should be at their optimal point because of problems with pretreatment. So this is an example. Red tides, which are quite frequent in the Gulf area, force desalination plants close down. 8 weeks are possible during a red tide, and these are 8 weeks in which water costs rise substantially. So we're talking about five times higher water costs because the plant operator has to supply water from other sources, also usually has to pay fines for not delivering water. And we had discussions with plant operators and utilities in the Gulf, and one of them actually told us the downtimes that they had in the last 5 years with their desalination plant could have financed a complete new desal plant. So when we really take a look at it, what's the Achilles heel of seawater RO? It's almost always pretreatment. So pretreatment or faulty pretreatment is responsible for about two-thirds of SWRO failures. So what's the best available technology on the market today? This would be absolutely best pretreatment that you can buy on the market today. It would be a combination of dissolved air flotation and low pressure membrane filtration, so MFUF, typically polymeric. And this process can deliver water of high quality to the RO membranes. It does have some serious drawbacks, and more specifically concerning the dissolved air flotation. So this is basic thermodynamics. If you dissolve air in warm saline water, you're going to lose a lot of energy. So if you take a look at the right hand side, this is the Henry's law for dissolving air in water. There's a linear connection with between what's the air concentration in the water and the actual pressure. You're delivering about above the liquid, and the warmer the water, more saline the water, the harder it gets to dissolve air in water. This is why dissolved air flotation is actually very energy consuming in seawater RO. It also has serious footprint, has complex operation because of a recycle stream, and it still requires an additional filtration step. As I said, best one would be membrane filtration, but in many plants you also see sand filter after the death. So what we do in akvolution, we do a new pretreatment process called akvofloat. This is a single unit operation combining both flotation and filtration, so membrane filtration, in the same device. And the nice thing about it is that we use only ceramic materials, both on the flotation side and on the filtration side. And these ceramic materials allow us to do actually induced gas flotation, so we inject air directly into the flotation tank. We don't dissolve air in warm saline waters, which is extremely inefficient. That means we need much lower energy consumption. Up to 90% reduction is possible compared to DAF. And we do filtration using ceramic membranes submerged in the flotation tank. These ceramic membranes allow you to work with high fluxes and create high quality effluent, which can then be directly desalinated. So this is a view of our prototype. Currently has a capacity of 12 cubic meters per day. You see here the ceramic diffusers creating the microbubble. This is really water kind of looks like milk, so white water, and the submerged ceramic membrane, further polishing the water. See here the float layer at the top. And this process works extremely well. We've had a very successful test run using surface water from the river water in here in Berlin, where we also had to work under algae blooms conditions. We could basically remove all algae, really reduce turbidity and organic carbon, while at the same time working very high filtration fluxes. We're talking about 160 LMH or higher, which I think is about 94 GFD, if I'm not mistaken, and really low pressure levels for the flotation, so below 2 bars. Yeah, this means that if we compare our technology to best available pretreatment, so that would be DAF plus membrane pretreatment or dual media filtration, we can offer total water cost savings, mostly because of low operational costs, and additionally other positive points like saving on footprint, having much easier operation because we don't have a recycle stream, lower environmental impact, we use less energy, less chemicals, we produce really high and constant filtered water quality regardless of the water quality coming in, very high uptimes, and as I said, resistant to feed water variations, for example, also during algae blooms. As applications, we see quite clearly, first of all, SWRO pretreatment, but also the oil and gas industry with either upstream produced water or downstream wastewater in petrochemical plants where you need good systems, good solutions for oil-water separation. Both of these markets are growing quite strong in the last few years and will be continuing to grow in the next 10, 20 years. And both of them will soon reach $1 billion a year. So what we offer at this point are containerized plants containing our technology. So these are small, compact, pre-engineered plants which are standardized and require very short lead times. We can produce these plants very quickly and deliver them to the client. These compact plants can handle up to 800 cubic meters per day, single container, or more if you do numbering up the containers. And this offers, obviously, modularity and plug-and-play design for the customer, which makes the business model scalable because you move from a project-based business model to a product-based business model. Yeah, some points regarding our history, our timeline. So the whole thing started with university research with my colleague, Johanna Ludwig, which we have a typo here, and myself. So we've worked in the research, academic research point of view for the past 3-4 years. With my dissertation and her bachelor thesis, we've submitted patents both in Germany but also worldwide and also GCC region in 2012. In 2013, we received the first funding. So this is the pre-seed funding I was talking about, coming directly from the German government, the German Ministry of Finance. They supplied us with 400,000 euros, which are about 550,000 US. This helped us build the first prototype, which we had running for about 7 months using river cedar water here in Berlin, 12 cubic meters a day. We were very proud of being listed by WDR and Global Water Intelligence on the 12th place of the best 44 most promising future water desalination technologies. And we are currently starting up a new pilot with Aquadome, which is Berlin and one of the world's largest seawater aquariums here in Berlin, where we will process their saline wastewater. Our plan is to have the first demonstration plant running in the Gulf this year with the help of our partners and investors. So as I said, the team is extremely important. We have a very diverse international team. So Johanna Ludwig comes from Berlin. She's a chemical engineer, worked on this technology for 3 years now, and is responsible for the R&D work. Lucas León, my colleague, comes from Spain. He has several years of experience both in the water industry and the startup scene in business development, marketing, and finance. We have Alexander Hoog, our project engineer and piloting guy, and myself. I come from Israel. I studied chemical engineering and did my PhD on this topic exactly. Additionally, we have an industrial mechanic on board. This is our guy in the workshop, building everything. Our mentor, Professor Gunter Wozny, is also worth mentioning, having over 30 years of experience in plant design and construction. Yeah, so as a summary and lessons learned, I would say probably the most important steps that you have to take in successfully starting your own company and bringing it to growth is, first of all, obviously innovate. So you got to have innovation in both technology and the business model. You have to get market feedback right away, as soon as possible. Start talking to future clients, see what their pain points are. Build a strong team with a lot of experience, both on the technology and market side, the business side. Write a solid business plan. Most importantly, you got to know your financials. Get finance. Scale up your technology and commercialize it as fast as possible and generate revenues as fast as possible. And I think this is the way to go. And I wish all of you good luck if you're thinking about starting your own company. It's a lot of fun, a great adventure. And yeah. That's all on my side.
Thanks very much, Dr. Beery. Thanks very much for that presentation. We're now going to move to the questions portion of the session. And as a reminder, you can go just below the YouTube video and post any questions if you like. I can try to get to them. Let me first start with a question for Dr. Stover. Dr. Stover, you've had significant experience with startups. So maybe you could tell us about a time when you had to reorient your strategy and what you learned from that experience.
Sure. With the Desalitech, the technology and our products were developed initially for seawater desalination, for lowering energy and seawater desalination. And we went after that market for a period of time. And we definitely sold some plants. However, what we found was that we had a much bigger market on the brackish and industrial water side. We brought more of a value proposition. And so that was some pushback we got from the market, and new doors opened. And so what we did was we really substantially changed our business plan. We changed who we were going after, what our product, how we would market our products, and you know, where we would work, which was our decision to move the headquarters to the U.S. And so that pivot or that change in business plan, I think, is a pretty fundamental thing that a lot of successful startup companies have gone through. You know, it's to come to a dawning realization, schooled in the realities of the markets you're going after.
And was that something you saw at ERI as well, or in that case, was it more of a home run in terms of the market?
No, ERI, well, so ERI had a terrific product right out of the gate. We developed a larger device, which made it more suitable for broader markets. But now the challenge for ERI was that it was mysterious how the device works. Still, it's not fully understood, but it does work. There are thousands of them out there. I think the primary hurdle for ERI was just simply sales and, you know, pushing something new into a very conservative market.
Right, right. And Dr. Beery, I don't know if you had a similar experience, because we can see from your presentation that you've talked about seawater and also oil and gas applications. Do you think it could also be possible that, in fact, there's a market, there's a reorientation needed away from seawater, or is it slightly different in your case?
No, it's not different. Well, I guess the big difference is that we are still very early stage. So we still haven't had the need to pivot as many startup companies do at some point. But we have been getting a lot of feedback, for example, regarding oil and gas, that's definitely the way to go, and not so much focus on seawater or oil. But that's something we're really looking into at the moment.
And I know that in desalination, it's very important to think about the regions that you serve. And so maybe, Dr. Beery, are there some insights you could share with your strategy on how to reach markets that are maybe not where your home base is?
Yeah, that's a very good question. Desalination world is obviously very international. Large parts of the market are in the Middle East, or the U.S., or Australia, or China. So far away from home for us, from Berlin, which means that if we want to access these markets, we have to have strong local partners to work with. This is also very strongly looking into at the moment.
Right. Partnerships. And maybe I could just go back to Dr. Stover on that one, because you actually just mentioned how there was a shift over to the U.S. You might be able to come in with some thoughts there, Dr. Stover.
Yeah, definitely. As far as target markets, it really helps to go local initially. Try to work with folks that are in your geographic region, and there's a lot of reasons for it, but one of the main ones is you're pretty much not going to make money on your first few installations, but that's not what you're trying to do. You're trying to make friends. And given that you're going to have to, you know, do a lot of adjustments in the field inevitably, and that you really want to apply very heavy-handed and close customer service to your initial projects, it helps not having to fly, you know, through multiple time zones to get to your project sites. It really helps if it's a place you can drive to.
Right. Great, great. Now, another topic I wanted to move on to was that of intellectual property, because I see that that's quite a core aspect of the technologies that you're both working on. And so maybe starting with Dr. Beery, you mentioned that you filed some patents early on. I'm curious to know whether, were there some lessons you learned the hard way yet, or is it still too early to say in terms of intellectual property?
Not yet. So far, I hope, I think we've taken all the right steps. We've filed for patents really as soon as we've had the first results. We have really good consultants or coaches on that part.
Great, great, great. And Dr. Stover, again, a lot of what you've been involved in has been fairly IP intensive, I would say. Is the desalination industry like any other industry in terms of intellectual property, or is there some advice you would give to entrepreneurs with regard to IP?
Well, you know, really investors need IP. You know, it's hard to get real investment if you don't have intellectual property protecting what they're investing in. So I think it's important. You know, one thing I'll say about IP is that there's all kinds of it. their patents, trademarks. There's also trade secrets. And all of that is valid IP. So how you manage that as a company is pretty critical. IP, you really need it. The main reason is for investment, for the longevity of your company.
And just kind of jumping onto that matter of investors, would you say that the investors, is the relationships there are as important as the IP or the technology itself? What has your experience been at both ERI and where you are now?
So what's more important, IP or technology?
Sorry, I'd say technology or investor relationships.
Oh, I see. You really need both, but I would say probably, at least for me, I'm a technologist, so for me the challenge is really the financial and commercial sides of the business. I feel like any technical problem could eventually be solved, but getting into market takes some magic and influence and a lot of compromise and give and take.
Yeah, great. And maybe to come back to Dr. Beery on the question of very early stage startups, one of the advantages I feel that startups have is that they have a lot of speed in relation to maybe some slower moving larger companies. But when you apply for grants, as it seems you have, then perhaps that can add some delays. Could you maybe provide some discussion around getting grants in the early stages and what the pros and cons are of taking that kind of an approach?
Yeah, so you've already pointed that out. So grants are great for the early stage part, but they do take a lot of time and work. So again, my advice would be start as soon as possible. So our experience, I can tell you, this pre-seed grant that we've received, €400,000, it took us about 10 months to get.
Right, absolutely.
That's a serious delay, yeah.
We just actually have a question coming in to move maybe to a technical question from some of the more business discussion we've been having. And this one's for Dr. Beery. We've got a question here from Kim Hack asking, are you using a vacuum to pull the permeate from the ultrafiltration ceramic membrane? Maybe you could give some insights around that, Dr. Beery.
Yes, so this is a submerged batch heat membrane. So obviously in order to create or transmembrane pressure, you need to suck the water out of it. So yes, you are using vacuum. Transmembrane pressure is very low, so we're talking about 0.1 to 0.2 bars. So below atmospheric pressure.
Right, great. Now, maybe to move to a final question, we're almost about to wrap it up for this webinar. I thought I might provide an opportunity for you both to chat a little about the importance of revolutionary versus evolutionary technology in desalination, and whether, because desalination might be a lower risk market, it tends to favor technologies that are maybe bringing about incremental change. Dr. Stover, I don't know if you have any thoughts on that question.
Well, I keep bringing it back to investment, and because I think it's a really critical thing, and not only getting enough money, but getting the kind of investors that you want at the right time when you need them. This is a question that really is on the table right away with investors. And that is, is this a disruptive technology? Is this really different, or is this just an incremental improvement on, what's already available to people? And they want disruption. They want something that's really going to change the world, and who doesn't, right? So sometimes, though, it's really, you can't do it with just what you're developing. Sometimes you have to combine what you're doing with some other breakthrough development or some other something else that's compatible, and that matchmaking is very hard to do as an entrepreneur focused on a specific technology. A lot of times you need friends or connections or influence to bring in another partner. But and obviously what's happening there is you're increasing the risk, Because in a case of a collaboration, if either one fails, it hurts the other. But you're also increasing the upside. And that's what, especially venture capital, is really looking for, is an enormous upside. They're willing to take some losses along, you know, with some of their investments if they get the big pop on one or a couple.
And Dr. Beery, would you like to come in with your thoughts on evolutionary versus revolutionary technology?
Yeah, very good point there. I have to agree 100%, Rick. So, obviously, disruptive is great, and that's also what the investors always want to see, disruptive technology, because they want technology that could really make a breakthrough in the market and turn this company into a billion-dollar company. But the market service that is a more technology to get to the market, and the more time and money it will take to really commercialize it.
Great. Well, with that, I think we'll bring the webinar to the close. I'd like to sincerely thank both of our speakers today, Dr. Beery and Dr. Stover. This webinar was, of course, brought to you by the International Desalination Association's Young Leader Program. And we look forward to joining you again for our next quarterly seminar in about 3 months' time. Until then, please get in touch via our website, idaylp.org. Goodbye.